I'm pleased to say that today is supported by IE University School of Architecture and Design. They share our passion for making sustainable and equitable future places. And they offer an amazing hybrid courses that you can do from anywhere with some amazing class trips. So I'm going to invite the Dean of the School of Architecture to join me on the stage now, Martha. So Martha, it'd be really good to hear from you. We're hosting this talk a few days before International Women's Day. You and I have worked together on many initiatives in the past to encourage more women into the built environment. And I know you were also at the center of the initiative to expand the definition of the Pritzker Prize to include the recognition of collaboration and couples. So I would really like to hear from you about some of the work you're doing at IE University to encourage women into the profession and around your perspective about women's role in the built environment in general.
Thanks so much, Christine. It's really nice to see you again. And what a special day to hear Natalie DeVries. It's going to be great. Absolutely. At IE School of Architecture and Design, we believe in diversity. We believe in multiple voices and different points of view. And of course, women lend a lot to that debate and discussions that we can have. I'm pleased to say that in the fields of architecture and design, our faculty and student ratios are really, really good. We have lots of talented women as students and faculty members making really good contributions to the educational experience. In the field of real estate, it's surprising because the faculty ratio in terms of gender parity is good, but still we don't have as many women students as we would like in real estate. And I think it's fitting as we're looking to this month celebrating women and their talent. It's a good opportunity to encourage women to think about real estate and the many roles that they could fulfill in that field as a career path. And you and I have talked about why women are not so much in real estate. Well, I think it has to do with historical reasons. It has to do that with the fact that real estate was often seen as bricks and mortar. On the other hand, I'm really pleased to say that it's changing. Real estate is now being seen much more as city making. There are many roles from public sector to private sector, from investment, development, to creating spaces for people through community development and other actions. I think there's a broad range of positions for all people and ones that could be very attractive to our women students upon graduation. So if I could just mention, we do have two real estate master's programs. One, as you mentioned, is part-time. People can continue to work and study, or if they have family or personal obligations, they can study part-time over 15 months. Unfortunately, it's on Saturday when the remote class time takes place. On the other hand, it's a great opportunity to connect with people from all over the world and our top-notch faculty. There are residential periods in Madrid and also in Mexico and at an Urban Futures Conference for the part-time program. And our full-time program, which also starts in October, is a little bit shorter. It goes October through July. And we look forward to welcoming people in Madrid for a face-to-face experience, or if COVID prevents us from always being together, we have a very flexible hybrid model. So we're ready for any eventuality that may occur in the future.
Martha, if they want more information, where should they go or what should they do?
Well, we will put in the chat the address. We have Eugenia Bollman, who is an admissions advisor. And we also have Victor Alanyard, who helps with career paths. And one more thing I should mention, Christine, because we are devoted to women in all phases, and we know that different moments in life require different types of support, we do have 3 women's scholarships. And so I encourage people to speak with a Eugenia or Victor, because there's a scholarship with a mentorship program. There's a scholarship directly targeted to women to enter real estate. And then there's one for the whole university, which is a high impact or high potential award. And for this, you just have to be outstanding in any field. But I'm sure that there are many women who want to become even more outstanding in the field of real estate development.
Martha, I want to bring you back afterwards to have some reflections. I know how much you're looking forward to Natalie's talk as much as I am. Do you think we need more women in real estate to shape our cities? Do you see that impact on our built environment?
Absolutely. I think diversity of any sort is the path. When we have more voices, and I'm sure Natalie will talk about this in terms of architecture and her role in the city, when we believe that the way forward is richer, more consistent, more democratic, when it is open to many voices, then and those voices express lots of concerns about sustainability, about new ways of living, about needs of a broad population. So we definitely need more women in real estate, probably in many fields. On the other hand, I think we're at a really good time where there is a transformation going on in real estate in cities. So it's a perfect time to study and jump into the pond.
Well, thank you very much. And thank you for supporting this event. And I'm going to send you down the magic slide back to the audience. You'll be joining us later. So give a wave.
Great. See you later. Bye.
And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Natalie DeVries, co-founder and principal architect and urban designer at MVRDB, a studio that works at the intersection of architecture and urbanism. They're known for their innovative and experimental work. DeVries was also recently appointed city architect of Groningen. So please give an emoji round of applause to Natalie. Natalie, come back.
Thank you. Well, that was a lot of inspirational talk about women in the field. And today I'm talking to you from Groningen, indeed, as in my role as city architect here. We have fortunately a lot of female colleagues as well. So things are going all right here, but they can always go better. They always can be better, of course. Thank you. Thank you for giving me the stage and being able to give this lecture to you today from at least 2 of my positions. And I will start to share the screen. Is that okay?
Brilliant. Christine? Yeah, go for it. We can't wait.
Okay.
I'll just stick around until I know your slides are up, and then I will vanish and return for the Q&A.
Yeah. So Christine, tell me, do you see my first slide now?
Audience, can you see it? Everything?
Yeah. I am I'm seeing my screen now. So I just have one question. Do you see my mouse as well if I move it?
Yeah, I don't. Okay. I don't see your mouse.
Okay.
Maybe somebody.
Well, then I just have to explain as good as possible. Thank you. Okay.
Great. I'll see you afterwards.
I'll see you afterwards. So hello everybody, and looking forward to hear your comments afterwards. So I'm going to talk today about resilient communities, and of course the motto of the whole festival is of course shaping better places. And I have a motto in design, which is that in order to make our built environment more livable, transformable, and resilient, we need to create spatial designs that are also more productive and multiple. What that is, I'd like to show you on different scales today, because I work on different scales, and that's something I like very much, and sometimes also from different positions. I want to show you on 3 different scales projects that I made, that we made as MVRDV, buildings, the neighborhood scale, and a plan for a metropolitan region. And I will end with my most recent position as a independent advisor city architect of the city of Groningen in the Netherlands. And I always nowadays start my lectures with 2 images. One is we are in the middle of a very big transition, which is caused, of course, by the digitalization of our society. And it has an impact on everything we do, how we work together. But it also gives tremendous opportunities for designers to start to use this in their work. On the other hand, it also takes good, you have to take good care of what your position is in the new networks that are arising. And secondly, of course, everybody in this audience probably knows this, as spatial designers and working in the built environment and the bricks and mortars, we have a huge impact on the environment, because although cities occupy only 2% of the total land, the impact on the economy is huge, 70% global energy production, consumption, if only it were production, greenhouse gas emissions and producing of waste. So what we do, what we design, what we decide matters. And like in the introduction is also said, it's important that we do that with a diverse community. Also inside our office, we have many, many people working on the projects that I'm showing you. So they're absolutely not my personal thing. We've done it together with people like these here, very mixed community, diverse community from our offices in Rotterdam, Shanghai, Paris, and Berlin. So I thought let's start with some buildings and how they can impact the environment. Of course, public buildings, very important. And I would like to share with you a design made together with Adept Architects in Frederiksberg, which is a community inside the city of Copenhagen, that had this wonderful idea of in their neighborhood that was in transformation, and a lot of new buildings, new houses were made in an old neighborhood to also start to build a community center. But the fantastic thing about this community center is that it's not just a community center, but it also takes care of body and mind in many ways. And we developed a concept here that integrated all these different functions that it can have. Here you can see it's positioned between the old and the new parts of Frederiksberg, but also adjoined with a wonderful garden on top of a car park, so that you can also enjoy the community outside. And what was important in this design is already this multitude, or this multiplicity, as I call it, because it's a building that has many functions, but a lot of them can have double or triple use. So you have individual areas in the building, but the whole building in the weekend, for example, also doubles as a huge playground, which is important in Copenhagen, where it can be cold and dark. So the whole layout and design is catered towards this double use. So it's not something which is always automatically in the brief. It is also the way how, as an architect, you can organize your space. And I think it's a wonderful tradition that is now arising in Denmark, that they create these new community centers again, where you can meet, where you can learn, where you can have a startup workplace, but where you also learn to cook together and how to have a healthy life. And this Scandinavian tradition, I wish we could also copy in many places, for example, in the Netherlands or in Groningen, where I am currently. But you might say, well, that's a public building and there's public interest and public funding, although there are also yoga classes and private entrepreneur in this neighborhood center. What about when you start to build, let's say, a completely privately developed building? In this case, we made a co-working office right in the center of a Polish town called Wrocław, and that's where we start to talk. And this developer, this entrepreneur, also had it high on the list. If we occupy such a central place, maybe as a private company, you can also give back to the city. And so the whole building, which is partly using existing ruined facades that were still on the site and integrated that in the new building, gives a fantastic roof terrace, adds art to its restaurants and meeting places, and makes the whole environment more active and accessible. So this is a building, although it's private, that completely, let's say, opens up its lower floors and its top parts. It acts as a beacon of light in the evening, making it a nicer and safer place to go. And who would think that a co-working office can be a great place to go? And so it's not just the public sector, but also the private sector, and with us, with the help of architects, that can help to create this kind of spaces. Wonderful is, I think, in all cases and in many projects, also always the collaboration with local, or she's national known artists who made the fantastic murals about reflecting history of Wroclaw. Alicia Biala, who greatly contributes to this space, and that indeed it is a beacon. So very interesting to think of buildings, even if they're not publicly accessible, if you can somehow negotiate accessibility on rooftops and the plinths of buildings, and then you can work together really greatly. On the neighborhood scale, we also design with quite a particular attitude. We now go to Brittany in France, and this is a project of housing surrounding a nice cafe and on a historical spot of an old tax office. Therefore, the word octroi. So this is actually, of course, a kind of regeneration project, structuring a place that was formerly not used for housing. And you can see here also what kind of dialogues we then have with the community, in this case, in the competition, with the politicians and the jury. We always show what we at least should do in the velometry. But then we say, wow, how can we make this place truly interactive and porous? Because it's such a nice site. It would be a pity if it doesn't open up more to the context. And if it's not acting like a wall, but more like small landscapes. And in that way, we can even give more people in the building and around the buildings views and terraces. And then literally, as a fourth step for everyone. And wouldn't it be nice if we then also really green those terraces to emphasize its organicness even more? And then in the next step, we also added cross sections through the building, opening up so that we're able to walk and see through the building. And we're currently talking to artists again to create public lobbies inside the building as well. To really make it interact with its environment very well. Cars are parked underneath. A landscape is made. The waterfront is made more accessible. And by introducing these big hallways in the little image, I always know that even though it's it wasn't in the program, that these will be places where people can meet and potentially even organize events together with the other inhabitants in the building. You have already, let's say, a festive space for that, or a space to hang around. And fortunately, it's very mixed and diverse through the local regulations. The municipality made sure that on such a prominent spot near the city center of Rennes, the community that will be living here is really mixed. It's really a mixture of all kinds of affordabilities, and it also includes a part that is super sustainable in passive house style. If only it could be the complete project, but well, that was probably the reality in 2018 out there. But we've learned enough to do more and bigger projects this way. And we really wanted to give this whole building this atmosphere of an ensemble. And like I said, we wanted to green the terraces so everybody gets their own pots and water taps on their balconies to make sure that these plants can be maintained as well. And we'll be greening some collective roofs as well. And here you see the effect of one of the porosities, as the French call it, porosité, entrances that double as meeting spaces. And of course, some commercial functions, retail functions at the bottom as well. And like in our other buildings, how can we also make a socially safe place by creating also beacons and lights in the public space in the evening? And fortunately, it's under construction. So the proof will be in the pudding, of course. Continuing with neighborhoods in a city in Eindhoven, again a sort of densification of an even larger scale. It's something we do very much with our office, is that we use data and urban information to optimize our densification strategies. Yes, sometimes new and unique shapes are emerging from our urban ambitions, like in the previous scheme as well. And in this case, optimizing the amount of square meters that we can build without compromising the quality in the streets meant that we created this rather specific shapes for housing. And but in an interesting way, it also fits some of the existing buildings in yellow that are already on the site from the post-war era, sort of classic modernism. And and you will see that we can also use these roofs. We can use these roofs to make more apartments with nice balconies, but we can also use it to green the roofs and to create some fantastic rooftop spaces for the inhabitants to use. Again, here the car is removed from the street. It's below in car parks, and the different positioning of the building allows us to make different types of collective spaces. We make sure that it's being greened as well, because that's important too. And it is important to deliver also a diversity of outdoor spaces, I think, when you create a new neighborhood. Eh? Like we like to position our buildings in such a way that we make sort of semi-courtyards, smaller and wider shared spaces, and even bring that up into the buildings. And here, you also start to see, of course, that the new reality is, fortunately, and in the Netherlands we are emerging fast in this direction, is that we try every possible thing to integrate sensible elements in the schemes regarding water and energy collection and green and good building. Like I said, a view of this collective spaces we are making as much as possible in spaces. In our projects, whether on demand or integrating them with corridors and entrances, because this is also a way how you can create community to make spaces that where things can be shared. And we notice, fortunately, more and more that that there are amenities added to housing projects. It's not just an endless amount of repetitive houses, but that you also add amenities to the scheme that people can use together. And I think the past months have learned us how valuable these kind of spaces close to home can also be. I was imagining that I would be talking for a large part also to a British audience, so I couldn't resist adding an old scheme we once made about the densification with townhouses in an old town in the city of Leiden. And maybe it's nice today to articulate in particular what I never talk about. Obviously, you see we create blocks where back-to-back houses are built on top of a half-hidden, where car park is hidden inside. But we also try to create different public spaces in the area. And I was actually specifically having kids in the back of my mind. Now, this project was quite particular because people built in groups, but also were able to individually tune their houses. And even the housing corporation stepped in and also so a very dense typology where you have close to your home patios and sometimes roof terraces, but also, and this is one of the examples by another architect who did an infill in this house in a very basic, basic way. But you also see here the cars were taken out of the street, and the people were allowed to co-create their and select their own infill for the streets. So they build it together with the people in the back of the block and with their neighbors across the street from the other block. They also created different streets, and I went there again 2 summers ago to see it after 10 years of building, and found luckily all these kids hanging around and stuff. It was quite a hot day, but lots of signs of using, and also for the bigger kids we created next to, you saw some big patch of water. We had this sort of hangout for the little bit older kids that are sitting in the lawn on the lawn here, and the smaller kids who have their own special playground as well that can also be supervised by parents if they go there. So all of this builds up, I think, to a good neighborhood in my opinion. I keep on talking very fast because I have so much to show to you. On the large, very large metropolitan region scale, we participated in a resilient by design project in the United States. And after we finished our group work with an international team, we teamed up again with Dutch firms, Deltares, an independent water and soil research center, colleagues of One Architecture, mobility consultants of Goudenbeek-Koffing, and we were supported also by the Dutch state and local embassy to check again on what we thought was actually a very Dutch approach that could help, and we thought it would be nice to offer that as well to California, to the Bay Area. The Resilient by Design Challenge was 2 years ago in San Francisco and the Bay Area communities. And this is just an image of many of the teams that participated and the projects that they made. They were all sort of localized. We were working on different spots. But as a Dutch collective, we'd like to think about the water on a bigger scale, as you might maybe expect from Dutch people. And it started, of course, with the analysis of the urgency of what is happening in this region. And there are many more regions, I think, in the world that have to face quite complex climate change developments, floods and droughts in California, but also a severe housing crisis. People stuck in cars for many, many hours because they have to commute. Also, again, because of high housing prices. And then there's, of course, your occasional disaster every now and then that happens as well with earthquakes and hurricanes and all these kind of things. Now, calmer image, the Netherlands, no hurricanes. We do have earthquakes, actually, in the area that I'm sitting in, but that's another story. But we thought we would like to bring another scale, the regional scale, to the table, and framed actually many of the problems as a combination of too little and too much. Too much water, too little water sometimes, rapid urban growth, all the risks I was just pointing out to you and to you all, and identified them for the whole area, and try to explain how everything is connected to everything, and how a simple solution in one neighborhood might be an answer, beginning of an answer, but it's by no means you should connect everything as much as possible on a larger scale. So this is just an inventorization. It looks dramatic, and it is dramatic, of all the topics that this region is facing. And what we like to do also is mapping and diagramming and visualize what we see. So all these aspects of too much and too little, we identify together with our team. I'm not going to read out all these images, but you can sort of imagine looking at all these images of fragmented policymaking, increase in sea level rise, problems of commuting and systems around the bay, of traffic. And I've been mentioning endlessly repeating bad solutions, planning uphill, but thereby increasing problems sometimes. And we also said, well, we are a collective working together. We are organizations of experts, designers. We want to collaborate with you on a municipal scale, but maybe also on a regional scale, because the tools we have to develop are systematic tools that we need. Water management, area development, inclusive design, sustainable mobility, and they all have to work together in a systematic way to be able to deal with this this topic. So the topics themselves are huge, but if all these small policymaking things are integrated and working together, you can actually form a really resilient way of working. And all the things added up form fantastic systems that might make the whole area more resilient. Eh? So, but you have to know how to integrate all these things together. Yes. So, as Dutch, we were thinking big on a larger scale, on the regional scales, and there are things you can only do if you work on that scale, like preventing everybody from getting wet feet, but you also have to implement them on a small scale. Everybody knows the example of the Dutch guy who puts his finger in the dike, because one little hole can make the whole country flood. So that means that also all the different elements in the network should be working together. Yeah? And if each initiative, individual initiative, follows at this guideline, together you can form very strong networks for resilience. So it ended in some recommendations, and we have an international water ambassador, Henk Oving, that is also showing this as an example worldwide, not just for this area. So yeah, advice: update all the plans with water and climate adaptations. We need this. You need this on a large scale to have these visions. We do this in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we also said maybe there should be one commissioner, not a politician, but an independent figure who is just concerned about solving the problems of resiliency. Don't make it political. You need long-term breath and long-term budgets to solve your problems. Talked about digitalization. Make sure you have monitoring systems in place. This is just a website on the Urban Groundwater Network of Amsterdam and of the Netherlands. Develop collective design principles. We should join forces together. Now, as people working in cities, you know, of course, what the good impact of collective visions on design principles can be. And you can start bottom-up and top-down and bring all this together. And that's a great way to do it and to achieve it. And you need both. And then you can create a truly resilient environment. Now, I am not a commissioner, and this is all the numbers that are also part of this positive outcomes that we could achieve when you work in such a way. You can house more people. You can be more effective with water that now gets lost. You can change the modal shift so that you don't have less transport problems, etc. So now I'm coming then to my fourth scale, the city. And I'm recently asked to become an independent advisor city architect to the city of Groningen. excellent, of course. It makes it possible for me to think and work and collaborate on the scale of a city, on the subjects that we've been that I've been talking about already for the past 30 minutes. And I just started 1st of January, but you can imagine, of course, my fascination for this type of job, because I am now really at the forefront of a city that has many, many projects running at the same time. Quite a progressive city. They have around 205 inhabitants. It's in the north, where I was born also, not far from this city, and I grew up. It's the fifth municipality in the Netherlands. A lot of jobs, students, international students. It's a very young city. Companies like to come here to start start up their firm. So far, the city marketing, you could say. To the right, you see the city boundaries. It also includes two villages. It's a very diverse city, very old university city, very historical development, but it also has universities, hospitals, developments from every thinkable era in architecture. And it has a lot of ambitions as well. Cities all having to do with the quality of life. They branded themselves the next city. It's about bicycle, green, sports, diversity, affordability, etc., etc. But as a designer, of course, I also know how complicated and complex it is to bring all these things together. And it also asks for new visions on old topics. Yeah? So how do you make a centuries-old square more climate resilient? Fantastic that this city was already in the 70s banned cars from its downtown. But, whoa, yeah, with all these people and bicycles, how is that going to develop and keep lively? Great station area is developed, but we also need to add more housing to this area now. It's political targets, build 20,000 houses. Do it mostly inner city, transform old neighborhoods, make sure that nobody tries to rip off students all the time with bad tiny apartments and rooms. This is just all the renewal in the city. I'm just giving my shopping list to you. How do you densify in inner city old industrial areas? Can you connect to the green and the water systems? It's all there. They organize manifestations a lot, this city, so you might have a look. But it also is a city that wants to become CO2 neutral, so there's discussions on where to put solar parks and windmills on top of putting a lot of solar panels on roofs and behaving more energy friendly, etc., etc. So an enormous laboratory of a sustainable city. It's a city that scores very well on a lot of lists regarding health and friendliness and sporty people. How does it stay that way also with all the growth and demands that the city has as well? So there you see a little bit my challenge for the coming years as well, apart from my own projects. Right, so I'm going to stop sharing. And this is what I can tell you so far.
From you. The sun has moved, so I'm a little bit shady. I'll have to just readjust. Yeah. But really great. So great to hear from you. I'm going to bring Martha back as well to join us. But you can see your round of emoji applause there. It's just so lovely.
Thank you. Thank you. Now I have to do lovely. This, I think. Yeah. Thank you. Right.